Well, thank you and welcome to the real graveyard shift. Hopefully this won't take the full 40 minutes that it was scheduled for, because time is getting on and we're running a wee bit behind schedule. What I want to do is a wee bit different to the presentations which have been delivered so far today, but hopefully it'll be something which complements them as well. In a day like this, I think that there is a risk that we can be suffering a little bit from information overload. And I think that my experience from delivering many seminars over a period of years is that it's very important to have a framework upon which to hang the individual skills which we're introduced to. So what I want to do is propose a system of clinical practice to help contextualise the information presented in the previous sessions, and then pick out one of those steps in that clinical system for particular attention, and that's to look at the association between abnormal foot function and musculoskeletal pathology, but in doing so, emphasising the nature of cause. Now, formulating an approach is, the approach that I use in clinical practice has got its origin in the Oxford Clinical Handbook of Medicine, which I read as an undergraduate in 1993. And in the chapter on endocrinology, it started off with the essence of endocrinology. And it basically said that all you have to do is define a clinical syndrome, match it to a gland malfunction, measure the output of that gland in peripheral blood, image the gland, and either find a way of stimulating it or find a way of inhibiting it. And I immediately thought, that's biomechanics. Honest. So that led me to come up with a concept of the essence of clinical podiatric biomechanics. And many of the skills which have been, or many of the concepts which have been discussed today, can fit into the various different steps within that essence of clinical biomechanics. First of all, diagnose a pathology. Secondly, diagnose a dynamic foot dysfunction. Thirdly, and very importantly, establish the association between the pathology and the dynamic foot dysfunction. Then identify the source of the dynamic foot dysfunction, and then find a way to control the dynamic foot dysfunction based on its source. And also, of great importance, is using additional treatments as is required. Diagnosing the pathology has been mentioned on a couple of occasions today, and this is something which is very important. As the statement says there, clinical diagnosis is an art, and the mastery of an art has no end. You can always be a better diagnostician. As soon as we can make a diagnosis, we can link various different information into it. When we understand its pathology, we understand its etiology, often it gives us some clues about treatment. So diagnosis is extremely important. We then move on to the second step, which is to diagnose a dynamic foot dysfunction. Now, when we're using orthotics, we must be convinced that the foot makes a critical contribution to gait, that abnormal foot function will affect gait performance, and that that altered performance may result in musculoskeletal pathology. So therefore, diagnosing the dynamic foot dysfunction is a critical step in practicing podiatric biomechanics. But in order to tackle that, we need to think about what exactly is meant by dynamic foot dysfunction. Now, I would define dynamic foot dysfunction as essentially being the failure of the foot to fulfill its stance phase functions. And that essentially can be broken down quite simply into shock absorption and loading response, a stable platform in mid-stance, and being stable in propulsion. Now, dysfunction can be in terms of the amount or timing of motion, and where those are thrown out, it can result in asynchronous limb function. To understand normal foot function, we need to take a look at what normal function is, and we've got various different bits of literature to help us understand this. This is a traditional perspective of rear foot function and stance, and this is the graph of rear foot motion which was presented by Root et al. In the 1970s, and essentially it starts from a slightly inverted position. There's a period of pronation, and then there's a gradual resupination until that magic point at 67% of the stance phase, where the heel lifts off the ground and it happens to be in subtalar joint neutral. The reality is somewhat different to that. So when we think about what constitutes normal foot function, if we see somebody who's pronated even a small amount and think that that's abnormal because neutral is where it's meant to be, then we're missing something. Trevor put up some results in the last presentation, shown a graph of motion presented by McPoyle and Cornwall recently. And they've done lots of work on this. They've done various different studies using different sample sizes. And what we really have to acknowledge now is that the normal foot is not in neutral. So when we actually take a look at the position around which the rear foot functions, it's actually slightly pronated. Now, I find this very interesting because it takes me back to one of my favourite papers, which was the function of the subtalar joint from clinical orthopaedics and related research in 1967, when Close and colleagues presented a classification of the foot based on the medial deviation of the subtalar joint axis. Is this ringing any bells from Kirby advocates? And they actually presented the classification as being the normal, somewhat pronated foot. I find that really interesting that in 1967 it was discussed that the medial deviation of the axis was important in classifying the foot, but the normal foot was somewhat pronated. So when we think about normal foot function and we're thinking about what constitutes normal, it's important to have a healthy tolerance for a small amount of pronation. We can get an insight into dynamic foot function by using some static tools. But one of the limitations of these is that they are based on static assessment. Again, Trevor's mentioned the foot posture index, which is one of the more useful tools that we have available to us now, and it represents a quantum leap over some of the tools that we had previously. Full details of the foot posture index can be found by following the link there, and very easy to find that just by typing in faster leads into Google. Faster standing for the foot and ankle studies in rheumatology. After identifying the dynamic foot dysfunction, we need to realise that it's not just about pronation. All pronation is not the same, and it's not just a matter of treating pronation as if it were all the same. There's not just one cause requiring one treatment approach. Both feet can be and frequently are different. Dynamic foot function and therefore dynamic foot dysfunction is determined by a set of neuromusculoskeletal circumstances. And I think what's interesting about various presentations today is that they've been focusing on the manifold causes of abnormal limb and foot function. And therefore our neuromusculoskeletal examination is vital in order to understand the origin of abnormal foot function so that we can then treat it in the most appropriate way. Now, one of the important questions which I want to focus on is this one about abnormal foot function and does it cause the pathologies we see? Now, to actually go about answering that question, it's a very complex question which can leave us quite confused in practice. Dynamic foot dysfunction, I don't believe that there's any such thing as a panacea. There's no one thing which can cause everything. So this creates a bit of a dilemma in me because I do actually think that there are common mechanisms associated with dynamic foot dysfunction which can be associated with various different pathologies. And they can be broken down essentially into these four mechanisms here. Prolonged pronation increases stress on pronation control mechanisms or forces. So for example, the tibialis posterior tendon, if it's contracting eccentrically to decelerate pronation and we have excess pronation, then that tendon will be overloaded. And there's a mechanism by which it can become damaged by abnormal pronation. The compensation that occurs can increase stress on other motion control mechanisms as well. Excessive supination can do the opposite and can result in mechanical imbalances, and then impaired shock absorption can result in increased force spikes to damage tissues directly. But in terms of thinking about cause, and does abnormal foot function cause the musculoskeletal pathologies we see, we need to think a little bit about the nature of cause. And in that respect, we can take some lessons from epidemiology. There's a definition of epidemiology there. It's the study of the incidence, distribution, and determinants of disease with a view to bringing about the prevention. And obviously a very important aspect of that is that these determinants of disease really equate to causative factors. In order to understand cause a little bit better, we need to understand that there are various different types of causal relationships. Hundreds of years ago, it was dead simple. You got exposed to an infective organism and you developed an infection. The exposure to the organism caused the disease. Very, very simple and straightforward. But it's now recognised that the sorts of diseases which we're developing are related to a multitude of factors, such that we've got various different factors which are necessary, which there can be different models. Necessary and sufficient is where you have to have exposure to that and the exposure is enough in its own right. You then have necessary but not sufficient in their own right, where we have to have a summative effect, where you have to have multiple exposures simultaneously. And then the causal relationships which we are dealing with most often are a situation where the variables are neither sufficient nor necessary. Now, to put that into context, If you want to have a heart attack, you don't have to have high blood pressure, but it helps. You don't have to have diabetes, but it helps. You don't have to be obese, but it helps. So that helps to sort of crystallise that concept of neither sufficient nor necessary. Now, a lot of the musculoskeletal pathologies that we are dealing with, there are lots of different causal factors, but they're neither sufficient nor necessary. You don't have to have them. Now, I find it kind of frustrating that we find it easy to interpret that concept in the context of a heart attack, but we find it difficult to interpret that in the concept or in the context of musculoskeletal pathologies. So I think that in order to answer that question about does abnormal foot function cause the pathologies we see, we need to spend some time thinking about it. Now, because of that complexity, it leads to cartoons like this. This creates confusion in the media, where we've had news headlines over the past fortnight saying that I think that salt is now good for you. I think there was some press coverage of that. And of course, the press can't cope with the fact that there are actually complex causal pathways at work. And it's either expected to be a cause or not. And it's not as simple as that. So in a situation where the most complex model probably most accurately describes the causal relationships that operate in most chronic diseases, and I would argue that they can be applied to the musculoskeletal pathologies that we see. And another cartoon. But I believe that it's these complex causal relationships which lead to controversy and actually lead the public to misunderstand the dangers of various different risk factors. Now, in terms of thinking about that concept of cause, the epidemiologists present us with a concept known as the criteria for inferring causality, and there are multiple factors that they set out which they suggest have to be fulfilled in order to say that a particular factor causes a particular disease. Now, what I'm most interested in is, or the one that's really grabbed my attention, is the causal explanation is biologically plausible. So I think that whenever we are faced with a musculoskeletal pathology and someone who has a particular pattern of abnormal foot function, the challenge that we have after we've diagnosed it, is to say, well, I wonder how abnormal foot function can cause that particular pathology. And when we understand that relationship, we can get insight into what we're actually trying to do to solve the problem. I also wanted to mention something in these criteria which came up in one of, I believe, Brian's presentations earlier, which is the temporal temporal nature of the relationship, that we must not make the mistake of thinking that because we see two factors together, that one caused the other. Just because we see two things concurrently doesn't mean that there's a causal association between them. Now, the prominent example that I use of that is from some years ago, Tim Kilmartin did a PhD looking at pronation in juvenile hallux valgus. And by the end of his study, he really began to believe that you don't really develop a really significant hallux valgus until you've got a pronated foot. So he began to entertain the possibility that there are some feet in which hallux valgus is a consequence of, that pronation is a consequence of hallux valgus and not the other way around. So the temporal nature of the relationship between variables is very important. But the one that I want to focus on is this idea that the causal explanation should be biologically plausible. And what I'd like to do is focus on that, illustrating, using a couple of different examples to show some of the thoughts that I have and some of the work that we're actually trying to do. I'm going to give some examples of some research that we're doing in Cardiff, which is focusing on this step, which we see as being very important. So, establishing a biologically plausible explanation linking dynamic foot dysfunction and pathology. Now, that's the mechanisms again. So, before I begin with the two examples that I'm going to give, and the two examples are going to be knee pathology and medial tibial stress syndrome, which have already been mentioned already. But I think that there are common links and that this idea that prolonged pronation is going to increase stress on pronation control mechanisms. There are certain places we can look for pathology, and we need to understand if a particular tissue is trying to control pronation or it's trying to limit it. And we also need to think about, very importantly, the way that abnormal position influences joint contact pressures, because that can cause pathology as well. So the first example is dynamic foot dysfunction in knee pathology. Now, this is very often presented in a very didactic way, that it's very simple, that we have a subtalar joint which is pronated, which results in internal rotation of the limb, which distorts the knee position. It results in quadriceps imbalance, and we get factors like abnormal patellar tracking. Now, that's probably, I would suggest that that's conventional wisdom, that we believe that to be the case, but it's one of these situations where we've not actually got a lot of hard evidence for it. So one of the first piece of research that I want to put up here is a study done by one of my colleagues who took a look at 335 subjects and classified them according to their foot posture index score. And she actually sought to determine whether there was a clear association between foot posture and knee alignment. Now, she used various different measures of knee alignment, including the Q angle, the tibiofemoral joint angle, the modified A angle. And she also she used the foot posture index categories, but one of the things which she did was any subjects who were borderline, who were on the threshold value for one category, were discarded. So we ignored those so that there were subjects who could really be thought of as being representative of that category. And she found that there was actually a clear association. She found that she was able to build up a profile saying that when you are in a when you have a pronated foot posture, then your Q angle, your tibiofemoral joint angle, and your modified A angle will all respond in a predictable way. So we actually have profiles linking this now. Now, that occurs through the torque conversion mechanism, and the torque conversion mechanism is something which is of absolute fundamental importance. Now, I was really interested to see Trevor saying that he still looks at the difference between neutral and relaxed, because this is actually the second piece of research that I'm working on just now. Now, this is meant to be a video, and this is a clinical assessment which I do on every patient that I see. I get them to stand in neutral, and then I let them relax, and I measure how much motion occurs of a bisection line. Now, I'm not interested in whether the calcaneus is absolutely vertical, whether it's inverted or everted, so it's not a neutral calcaneal stance position. It's simply in neutral. I want to know how far away relaxed is from neutral to know how much motion is taking place. So... this is actually is meant to be a video, but it's not running on my laptop, so the video is not going to work. But this is a really simple technique that can be used. And the study that I've been doing has been looking at the association between this measure, which I call static calcaneal compensation, and seeing if that is predictive of the motion that's occurring dynamically when walking and then when running. So we got a group of subjects and we measured a static calcaneal compensation, and then we took a look at them running and walking on the treadmill at a standardised speed and then running on the treadmill. And what we found was that there was a very good correlation between the two of them. So these two graphs are the static calcaneal eversion versus walking eversion. And in there, we've got the line of equality, which is a solid line, which would be the shape of the line if all the points lay on exactly the same, if they were exactly the same. And we've got the R-squared value there, which is a coefficient of determination, which is how much of X can be explained by Y. And we found there was a very good correlation. So the R-squared is a high value, but if you translate that to the actual correlation coefficient, it's actually higher. Now, that looks okay in itself, that there's a correlation between them. So when you measure static calcaneal compensation, that's given you a very good insight into what's happening dynamically. Now, I should have put in some other graphs here, because we've actually constructed something called Blond and Altman plots. Now, Martin Blond and Douglas Altman are some pretty famous statisticians from London, and they presented this technique for analysing agreement many years ago. And what they allow you to do is to look at the bias that's involved. So even though there's a good correlation, we know that there are different amounts of motion taking place statically and dynamically. So the Blond and Altman plot suggests that when you look at somebody statically and look at their static calcaneal compensation and then take a look at them walking, there's an average bias of about 6 degrees. So the static calcaneal compensation underestimates the dynamic by about 6 degrees, but there are fairly large limits of agreement of between 2 and 10 degrees. So there's actually quite a lot. But we can do some interesting things with that, because that indicates the range of the difference there is. When we actually take a look at what range 75% of our subjects fell into, it's actually a fairly narrow range of about 4 degrees. But what's interesting is that I think we can predict dynamic foot function from static assessment or a quasi-static assessment. But the important thing is that it's something that's convenient and can be done in 30 seconds in clinic. Now, the second example which I'd like to look at is medial tibial stress syndrome. Now, that refers to pain in the distal medial aspect of the tibia, in the posterior border. Trevor's done a review of that, and this is really the same information that Trevor's presented. Involvement in tibialis posterior has been rejected. I think that a couple of decades ago, it was believed that pain in that area could be tibialis posterior, but now that's been rejected because tibialis posterior isn't actually anywhere near where the symptoms are. But it's now generally believed to involve bone stress, inflammation, and perhaps raised intracompartmental pressure. The pathogenesis, Trevor put up some of these factors in his presentation as well. But the common thread here seems to be periostitis and some stress being applied to the tibia, provoking some sort of response. And the common mechanisms are believed to be training methods, training surfaces, and importantly, muscle dysfunction and inflexibility in shoe design and biomechanics. But it's likely to be multifactorial. So the question is, you know, can we come up with a biologically plausible mechanism associating abnormal biomechanics with medial tibial stress syndrome? So it's okay to say that we've identified pronation as a risk factor and it seems to be important, but the question then becomes, well, why? What is it about pronation that causes the medial tibial stress syndrome? Now, because there's been an identification that a periostitis is very important, then any causal explanation should in some way relate to the periosteal irritation. So if we take a look at this slide again and take a look at the factors that are likely to be uppermost in our mind, the biomechanics, the traction periostitis, and muscle dysfunction and inflexibility, they are things which come together and would seem to be candidates for linking the two together. Now, Trevor's already mentioned this study, and this is a really nice study. I really like what they did here. This was a cadaver study. If you can see the picture on the right-hand side there, you can see that that's a cadaver limb which has been transected mid-tibia. And I think the methodology was really interesting here. They put strain gauges at 3, 6, 9, and 12 centimetres proximal to the tip of the malleolus, and they got the posterior tibial flexor digitorum longus and soleus muscles, and they attached them to braided threads, and they applied a linear upward force, and they took a look at the strain that resulted in those strain gauges, which were in the medial aspect of the tibia, and they found that there was a linear relationship. Now, this tells us that when you apply strain to those muscles, then that's going to have some impact on the soleal fascia through which all of those muscles insert. So there's a potential mechanism if we can show how that increased strain on those muscles could occur in a pronated foot. If something that was happening in the foot could be associated with what was happening there, then it would perhaps explain the development of medial tibial stress syndrome and give us some clues about how to treat it. Now, when I've looked at this, I mean, I'm really presenting my thoughts on this. This is something that I don't have any research results on as of yet, but it's one of these things which is creeping up my list of priorities to get something done on. It struck me that ballistic stress has been regarded as important, and rather than say that it's just related to pronation, I really believe that medial tibial stress syndrome is a problem which is related to sagittal plane dysfunction. And I'll give an illustration of that here. So this is what my sort of model of the development of medial tibial stress syndrome. In that photo board there, the two photos on the left-hand side indicate the loading response. Now, if we use the protrusion of the medial malleolus and the frontal plane position of the calcaneus as the indicator of contact phase pronation, I hope that you would agree with me that that foot's not too pronated at that point. However, what we can notice in the second, third, fourth, and fifth slides is that when the contralateral limb is moving into swing and it's advancing forward and the ankle is being moved forward into dorsiflexion to facilitate anterior motion of the centre of mass, We've got an early heel lift, and we've got compensation. So what we've actually got here is a second period of pronation, which is directly related to the early heel lift, which is related to an equinus. Now, bear in mind that during the stance phase, soleus should have stopped the forward movement of the tibia in preparation for heel lift. I believe that that second period of pronation could induce a ballistic stress, because just as it's stopped functioning and the heel has lifted off the ground, there's a second period of pronation and a ballistic stress is applied, which causes that traction through the soleal fascia and causes irritation in the medial border of the tibia. I have to get some more data on this to investigate it, but a consistent finding in these patients has been that they've got that typical callus on the plantar medial aspect of their IPJ, and they display various other signs of sagittal plane limitation. So, the message that I'm really trying to put across is that I believe that a challenge in practice is to increase the confidence in the treatments we provide by identifying a biologically plausible pathway between the dynamic foot dysfunction and the pathology present. Just as Trevor said that we need to be making a diagnosis. We need to be making a diagnosis in terms of the presenting pathology, but also in terms of the abnormal foot function, and then importantly, linking the two together, because that's what justifies the treatment we're providing. I want to finish with my favourite quote. Okay. Thank you.